Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The 29% Solution, 52 Weekly Networking Success Strategies by Ivan R. Misner, Ph.D. and Michelle R. Donovan, narrated by Barry Abrams.
Preface. One you should really hear.
What do Santa Claus, the Easter Bunny, and 6 degrees of separation have in common? Answer. People all around the world believe in them. Now, we're not going to do an expose on Kris Kringle or the egg-laying rabbit. We don't want to stir up trouble. What we do want is to take issue with the 6 degrees thing. You've heard that there are 6 degrees of separation between you and anybody else on Earth that you would like to meet, right? Amazing, isn't it? Ain't true. Sorry, we hate to burst your bubble on such a lovely idea, but it's one of those urban myths that have grown from a small kernel of truth. The legend originally stems from several small world experiments conducted by Stanley Milgram in the 60s and 70s. These experiments involved sending letters from a group of people in one part of the country to a specific person whom they did not know in another part of the country. The participants were told to get the material to someone who might know someone who would know the individual to whom the material was to be delivered. This process formed a chain of connections linking the people together. It was in fact found that the letters that eventually arrived in the right person's hands took, on average, between 5 and 6 connections, or degrees. This part is true. However, if you look closer, you will discover the problems that exist within the blanket statement that we are all connected by 6 degrees. First off, though the average number of links for people who got the material to the final contact was 5 or 6 connections, the majority of the connections made ranged from 2 to 10. This means that roughly half took more than 6 and roughly half less than 6. Well, you say, that's the average, and we would agree that there's nothing wrong with addressing this concept by the average. But there's one small problem. The overwhelming majority of people in all of the small world studies never got the material to the intended recipient at all. In Milgram's most successful study, 217 chains were started and 64 were completed, a success rate of only 29%. That's right, a success rate of less than 1/3 of the participants. This means that 29% of the people in Milgram's most successful study were separated on average by 6 degrees from the final contact person. However, it also means that 71% were not connected at all. But wait, we're afraid it gets worse. This was Milgram's most successful study. In another of his studies, only 5% of the participants completed the chain, which means that 95% of the people in the study never made the link to the person with whom they were to connect at all, ever. Don't shoot the messenger, but we must tell you that we are not all connected with everyone in the world by 6 degrees of separation. We're just not. Not all of us. But why would the authors of a book on networking be telling listeners about the Achilles heel of this iconic concept upon which a lot of networking pros hang their hats? There are two reasons. First of all, we believe this myth creates complacency. The thought that everyone is absolutely connected to everyone else on the planet by 6 degrees gives some people a false expectation, lulling them into the impression that the connection is bound to happen sooner or later, no matter what they do. Second, and most importantly, the study's findings indicate clearly that some people are better connected than others. We believe that's important because it means that connecting is a skill that can be acquired. With learning, training, and coaching, people can develop their networking skills, increase their connections, and become part of the roughly 29% of people who are in fact separated from the rest of the world by just 6 degrees. Milgram's work was revolutionary, to be sure. It opened up a whole new world of discussion and understanding. It has also, however, been romanticized. The mythical version of his findings does no good for anyone.
It gives people a false sense of security and/or an erroneous worldview from a networking standpoint. We do believe that we live in a small world that is becoming smaller and smaller. We also believe it is possible to be connected to anyone in the world by only 6 degrees. We just don't believe that we are all connected by 6 degrees, and Milgram's own findings support that. The good news in all of this is that it is possible to be part of the 29% through education, practice, and training. We can be connected to anyone through the power and potential of networking. In fact, by understanding that, we can set ourselves aside from the competition by knowing that being able to make successful connections is not an entitlement. Instead, it is a skill that only some actually develop. We believe that you would like to be a part of that 29%. Why? Because you want to improve your networking skills. That's why. It's a no-brainer. The smaller the number of phone calls, letters, emails, lunches, and road trips between you and someone's ideal client somewhere in the world, the more value you bring to your networking partners, and the stronger and more prosperous your business networking becomes. That's one reason you need to listen to this book. Here's another. A survey of more than 2,200 business people at BNI.com revealed that 87% had never had a college course that even mentioned networking. We're not talking about an entire course on the subject. They are outnumbered by unicorns. We mean any course that even brushed on the topic. Yet, in another survey of more than 3,800 business people worldwide, 73% said they got most of their business through networking. Networking, which can help you build word-of-mouth marketing, is one of the most important ways for entrepreneurs to grow their businesses. More than 8 out of 10 business people belong to some type of networking group, according to an online survey at BNI.com of over 5,000 people, yet virtually no colleges or universities offer a course on the subject. Can this possibly be true? 6 degrees of separation shot full of holes, and colleges don't teach networking? It's almost too much to handle. We give people bachelor's degrees in marketing, business, and even entrepreneurship, but we teach them next to nothing about the one subject that virtually every entrepreneur knows to be critical to his business. Why don't business schools teach networking or word-of-mouth marketing? We think it's because most such schools are staffed by full-time professors who've never owned a business in their lives. Almost everything they've learned about running a business comes from books and consulting. Obviously, these professors, who are not practitioners, don't understand the importance of networking for entrepreneurs. Can you imagine a law course taught by someone who's not an attorney, or an accounting course taught by anyone without direct accounting experience? We humbly suggest that if you haven't actually owned a business, you might have a handicap in teaching a course on entrepreneurship. Business schools worldwide need to wake up and start teaching this curriculum. Schools with vision and foresight and the ability to act swiftly, sort of the way business professors claim that businesses should act, will be positioning themselves as leaders in education by understanding and responding to the needs of today's entrepreneurs. Business schools are, however, as bureaucratic as any large institution, so it's unlikely to happen quickly. That's too bad. Why? Word-of-mouth marketing works. Social capital is vital, and networking is the mechanism to develop both. As more universities and colleges open their doors to professors who want to include this strategy in their marketing curriculum, we'll see a major shift in the business education landscape. We'll see emerging entrepreneurs who are equipped with another tactic for success. We'll see networking utilized to its fullest capacity, and we'll see business schools actually teaching a subject that the business practitioner says is important. What a thought! Oh well, it's good to have goals. As of this writing, we know of 2 schools that offer regular, core curriculum, college-level courses on networking and social capital. The first is the University of Michigan. Its class is taught by Wayne Baker, co-owner of Humax Corporation in Ann Arbor. The second is Davis College in Ohio, and their class is taught by a friend of ours, Debbie Peters. Debbie uses the networking curriculum called the Certified Networker Program, www.certifiednetworker.com, developed by the Referral Institute, www.referralinstitute.com. Of the thousands of colleges and universities all around the world, only these two have a core curriculum course on the subject of networking. Is it any wonder that most business people are so hungry to learn how to improve this part of their business? Congratulations go to these leaders in the field for teaching something that every college should be teaching. So with almost no college courses available and few on the horizon, what are your options for getting good networking training? It's continuing education or nothing. There are a few good resources available for training outside of college, and there are a lot of good books. For more on these, we refer you to the final chapter of this book, Week 52 Strategy, Commit to Lifelong Learning, which discusses how you can become your own faculty advisor and design a continuing education curriculum for the art and science of business networking. But first, we want to congratulate you on choosing this book to start with, because the 29% solution is, we believe, a great way to bring yourself up to networking speed in a systematic, practical, observable way. And you don't have to swallow it in one big gulp. It's designed to lead you through a series of exercises, one per week, over a year. This allows you to spend an entire week incorporating each networking activity into your business routine. You don't have to do the exercises in any particular order. You can skip ahead, jump back, go directly to exercises that fit your current week's activities, or fill a gap in your skill set. It's about as user-friendly a book as has been written for a busy professional. And a built-in self-assessment will allow you to pat yourself on the back, or rake yourself over the coals, in the privacy of your own office. Hold my coals, please. Many of you feel that you are at the top of your game in some areas. If that's the case, feel free to concentrate only on the strategies that you judge to be the most valuable to you. But it's still a good idea to at least listen and think about the weekly strategies where you're already in pretty good shape, and even run through those exercises. It never hurts to check your assumptions, and it's good exercise for the networking muscle. By the way, for the 71% of people who are not connected but still believe in the 6 degrees of separation concept, keep the faith. You'll always have Santa Claus. Introduction. It's not net sit or net eat, it's network. Successful networking is about learning how to work the networking process, not just letting it happen. In many ways, success at networking is the perfect example of the uncommon application of common knowledge. Most people understand that networking is important to their success, they just lack a step-by-step process to get the results they want. Almost no one really incorporates a comprehensive methodology that will build a business through networking. Thus, the need to network is common knowledge, and the development of the methodology required to be successful at it is the uncommon application. By listening to this book, you will experience the true essence and meaning of networking. The 29% solution primarily addresses two conflicting questions that a business owner or salesperson faces every day. How can I tend to my existing clients while at the same time be out networking for new business? And should I place higher value on my current clients or on new clients? The word networking has become so overused that some business professionals can no longer define it. Many people think that networking is attending social or business after-hour events, shaking a few hands, collecting a few cards, and of course, giving away a few cards of their own. Sadly, they actually believe that's all there is to networking. To be fair, we could say they're engaging in social networking. That's never to be confused, however, with business networking. You'll find out why as you listen to this book. we've found that business people tend to fall into one of two groups when it comes to their views of networking. For many, the current mindset is that networking is a passive business strategy, not a proactive marketing tool. This attitude results in a scattered, often ineffective networking approach that consequently wastes the business owner's time and money. Not surprisingly, when people feel they've been wasting their time and money on something, they're understandably not going to continue that activity. On the other hand, some proprietors do consider networking a proactive marketing tool for their business. How can you tell? They make it a significant part of their marketing and business plans. They have networking goals. They may even have a budget line item for networking. Most importantly, they practice it and live it every day. Which view do you take? If you share the first mindset, the passive one, you're hoping that just showing up at meetings is enough. And therein lies the problem. But before you finish listening to the 29% solution, we're betting you will become, if you're not already, a staunch member of the second group, the proactives. Whatever your own current state of mind, by purchasing this book, you've already set yourself apart from some other business owners. Your willingness to listen to the 29% solution demonstrates your ambition to realize the full potential of networking for your business. The 29% solution is the first book designed to integrate networking into the way you do business on a weekly basis. This approach truly brings networking into your own business as a proactive marketing tool. You will find in this book 52 quick, straightforward networking strategies. Each strategy offers a specific focus for each week over a one-year period. We invite you to incorporate these proven strategies into your weekly planner, PDA, and Outlook calendar. Building these strategies into your life helps you maintain your focus on networking while you work to identify new revenue streams for your business. Before you know it, you'll be driven by the intention to get new business, and you'll have the networking tools to satisfy that drive. Because, let's face it, if you have no new business, soon you will have no business at all. What is business networking? Networking is the process of developing contacts and relationships to increase your business, enhance your knowledge, expand your sphere of influence, or serve the community. In its most basic form, business networking is leveraging your business and personal connections to bring you a regular supply of new business. The concept sounds awfully simple, doesn't it? Don't let that fool you, though. Because it involves relationship building, it can be a deceptively complex process. Think about it. How many people do you know? How many of these people truly understand what you do? How many of these folks have directed prospects to you as referrals? And how many of those referrals have actually turned into business? Business networking is much more than showing up at networking functions, shaking a lot of hands, and collecting a bunch of cards. Here's an example of what we mean. Imagine two people entering an event, sizing it up, and drawing an imaginary line down the middle. They separate, each taking half the room. At the end of the event, they meet again to see who's collected the most business cards. Have you met these people? Sure you have. We all have. What did they accomplish? They collected a lot of cards that will end up on a shelf, in a drawer, in the trash, or, worse yet, scanned into a computer so they can spam everyone they just met. Why? What does a business card represent? At this point, in reality, it's a piece of paper with ink and images on it. No relationship has been formed. This networking strategy by itself isn't an effective use of time, money, or energy. Some people get frustrated with networking because they seem to be making as much progress as a rear-wheel drive truck on an icy hill. 1 foot forward, 10 feet back, getting nowhere fast. Networking for business growth must be strategic and focused. Not everyone you meet can help move your business forward, but everything you do can be driven by the intention to grow your business. You have total control over who you meet, where you meet them, and how you develop and leverage relationships for mutual benefit. You have total control over whether you enter into the unique 29% of the population who are separated by 6 degrees, whether you stay there, or whether you never get there at all. Networking your business means you have to be proactive. That's why we say it's not net sit or net eat, it's net work. The 52 weekly strategies outlined in this book will help you focus your efforts so that you'll begin to reap the benefits of effective business networking. We recommend that you begin with the first section, Create Your Future. It's designed to be the starting point and direct you toward profitable networking. After this first section, however, you need not proceed in order. If you see a strategy farther ahead that appears to be particularly timely and helpful for your business, jump ahead in the book and do it. The point is to do something specific each week that is focused on networking for business growth. Remember, this is your plan, and you lead the activity. Why be good when great is an option? In his book, Good to Great, Jim Collins shares many examples of how great companies are different from good companies. In many situations, the differences are in the little things that are done exceptionally well. So it is with networking your business. Great networkers in the 29% produce exceptional results. Once you decide to be great, good is no longer an option. Great networkers move their businesses forward, but they don't do it alone. Great networkers have a plan, work to expand their network, go the extra mile, know how to get the most value for their time, communicate their messages effectively, become the experts, capture their best stories, and do what others don't do. People are drawn to them. New clients go to them because they hear about them from so many people. Great networkers don't need to do much selling, because many people come to them, ready to buy. Imagine that. People coming to you, ready to buy. Are you smiling? You should be. Becoming a great, effective networker is within your reach. Your income is directly related to your ability to network your business for growth. Are you ready to get started? Are you committed to actively growing your business by word of mouth? Have you decided that now is the time for you to advance from good to great? If you're ready, then let's begin by discovering how well you are networking your business right now. What are you doing well, and what are you doing not so well? You have to understand this in order to know where you're going. We know this can be difficult. Looking at yourself in a mirror and asking others to look at you too can feel pretty uncomfortable. Hey, we've been there. Now we're better and wiser for the experience. You will be too. We've made the process a little easier by providing a structured self-assessment tool. In the brief exercise that follows, identify your strengths and weaknesses. Be honest. Be brutally honest. Ask others for their perception of you as well. Every point referenced in the assessment will be addressed in this book. Thus, completing this self-assessment will help you get the most out of the 29% solution. It will help you focus on specific goals and accountabilities, and without a doubt, it will keep you focused on the true meaning of business networking. The 29% Solution Self-Analysis. For each answer, respond on a separate sheet of paper with 1 to 5, 1 equals not at all, 5 equals all the time. 1. I have written long-term networking goals. 2. I block out time in my weekly schedule for regular networking activities. 3. I can profile my preferred client as well as a TV profiler. 4. I have a strong team of referral partners. 5. I live by the giver's gain philosophy. I give business to others before I expect them to give business to me. 6. I have an organized contact management system that I use effectively. 7. I know the top 10 traits of a master networker. 8. I have a very diverse personal network. people from differing professions, ethnicity, age, education, gender, etc. 9. I know who can get me to my target market. 10. I keep in contact with people from organizations I used to belong to. 11. I make sure that my brother, sister, parent, family member can accurately explain what I do for a living. 12. I attend at least 2 networking functions or activities per week. 13. I belong to a web-based networking group. 14. I am someone whom people seek out when they need help. 15. I bring personal value to my relationships. 16. I typically am the one who puts the wheels in motion in a networking relationship. 17. I have a networking accountability partner. 18. I am an active volunteer for something meaningful to my life. 19. I send thank you cards regularly. 20. I consistently follow up on referrals within 24 hours. 21. I have found myself networking in a grocery store or elevator. 22. I capitalize on my hobbies to meet people. 23. I make the focus of my lunchtime meetings how I can help the other person. 24. I am good at making a connection when I meet someone new. 25. I am an active member of a referral networking group. 26. I am an active member of a chamber of commerce. 27. I sponsor at least 1 event per year for a referral partner. 28. I host an event for the people in my network several times a year. 29. I am skilled at asking the right questions of a networking contact. 30. I have created my message to be about the customer benefits of my product or service rather than its features. 31. I can consistently describe my target market without saying anybody. 32. I make sure that people hear the passion in my voice when I talk about my business. 33. I make a good first impression with my business card. 34. I provide information that is valuable to my audience whenever I give a presentation. 35. I send a newsletter to my business's clients. 36. I regularly put out press releases for my business. 37. I have written articles for publication. 38. I make getting client testimonials a part of my sales process. 39. I have provided my referral partners with success stories about my business. 40. I have prepared a written introduction for each time I am presented to a group. 41. I am comfortable sharing my accomplishments. 42. I make a practice of asking for feedback from clients. 43. I start new networking relationships by acting like a host at networking events. 44. I have asked my vendors for referrals. 45. I provide support to my target market beyond my services. 46. I ask for referrals every day. 47. I look for referrals for others daily. 48. I am comfortable speaking in public. 49. I surround myself with others who can help my clients. 50. I mentor others in the art, science, and philosophy of networking. 51. I have an advisory board for my business. 52. I enjoy learning more about how to network effectively. Total score? Scoring. 260. Master networker. You should be writing the next book. There is no doubt that your networking skills are remarkable. Most likely, you already are in the 29% of the population who truly are separated by 6 degrees. Your challenge now is to stay there. This book will focus your efforts and remind you of things that may have been lost along the way. 234 to 259. Outstanding! Way to go! You are in the 90th percentile. Clearly you know how to network. You are most likely skilled enough to be approaching the 29%. Your thirst for learning will have you devouring this book and learning strategies to further improve the return on your investment of effort in networking, and with commitment, move you into the 29%. 208 to 233. Very good. You are in the 80th percentile. You're doing many things right. Your effort can be very effective, and your relationships strong. This book will help you focus your plan and hone your skills to improve your effort even more, continuing to keep you moving toward that special 29% of the population. 182 to 207. Good. You're in the 70th percentile. The great thing is, you believe in networking. You clearly see the value in getting into the 29%. However, there's still a fair amount for you to learn. This book will forever change the way you view the process. It will focus your energy and give you the system you so desperately seek in order to gain a high return on your networking investment. You're in for a treat. 156 to 181. Fair. You are in the 60th percentile. On the bright side, you're probably building some good relationships around you. You most likely have people who care about you and want to help you and your business grow. They can be a resource to help teach you how to move toward the 29%. However, you could be doing some things that will hurt your business with respect to networking. This book will refocus your efforts and help you move further into the networking arena, one strategy at a time. 130 to 155. Weak. You are in the 50th percentile. Networking is an acquired skill. This book will help you realize the skill base you need in order to network your business. If you're ready to connect more closely with people and learn the skills necessary to be in the 29%, you've bought the right book. The world is waiting to know more about you and your business. 0 to 129. Help. You're in the 40th percentile or lower. Quick, listen on. Understanding your results. So what was your score? Before we move into section 1, let's take a few moments to talk about what the results of your own self-assessment mean for you. First off, your score is between you and yourself alone. It's not meant to be shared anywhere outside your own head. Whatever your score, remember that you're simply taking your networking temperature, so to speak, not engaging in any value judgments about yourself one way or the other. Indeed, if you take this self-assessment a few months from now, the score will probably be different, assuming you hear the rest of this book and practice some of the strategies with ongoing commitment. Section 1. Create your future. With the results of your self-assessment fresh in your mind, let's start creating your future, right here at the beginning, with Section 1. Now that you are more aware of your networking strengths and weaknesses, you can be realistic about the kinds of goals and plans you should make. Remember, you want to tailor the weekly strategies in the 29% solution to fit the real you, not the ideal you, because you won't reach your ideal over time unless you're clear with yourself about what you need to work on to improve your networking skills. Just as when building a new house, you need a strong, stable foundation on which to construct your networking home. We devote the first 7 weeks to helping you set goals, develop a plan, and accomplish other essential steps. By way of introduction, let's walk through an overview of the first 7 weekly strategies that will get you started. We recommend that you start with the week 1 strategy, set networking goals. Networking goals are vital. They keep you focused on the steps needed to network your business every day. Please pay careful attention to this process. In the week 2 strategy, block out time to network, you are challenged to carve out time in your weekly schedule for networking. Listening to this book is only one step towards strengthening your business network and getting into the 29%. To meet your goals, you must dedicate time to networking. The week 3 strategy, profile your preferred client, asks you to describe your preferred client in very specific and strategic terms. Knowing exactly who you want to attract to your business as a client or customer, and being able to clearly, concisely, and quickly describe that preferred client to everyone from your mother all the way down to the CEO of a Fortune 500 firm is a vital step for networking success. The week 4 strategy, recruit your word-of-mouth marketing team, shows you how to begin recruiting the individuals who will serve as your ambassadors. They are critical to your success. Why? Because networking, by definition, is a team sport. You win only when others are winning alongside you. Our week 5 strategy, give to others first, builds on week 4 and begins to demonstrate the power of the law of reciprocity in networking. This strategy focuses on the benefits of giving to others in your network first, before expecting anything in return. As they say in BNI, the world's largest business networking organization, givers gain. More on this later. The week 6 strategy, create a network relationship database, directs you to organize the people you know into a network database. An organized network database saves you time and energy in the long run. Finally, the week 7 strategy, master the top 10 traits, sets a high bar for you to clear. It outlines what a survey of business people deemed the top 10 characteristics that define a master networker. These same characteristics are what we feel separates those who are in the 29% from those who are not. It gives you something to aim for and a way of assessing where you stand now relative to that goal. Okay, that's where we're headed for the next 7 weeks. Now let's get going. Week 1. Set networking goals. Do you have goals for your business? Do you have marketing goals and sales goals? This is a perfect example of the concept we mentioned earlier, the uncommon application of common knowledge. We all know intellectually that goals are important. The question is, how well do we apply that knowledge? How about networking goals? If you don't have any, believe it or not, you are in the majority. Obviously, you believe in the power of networking or you would not have purchased this book. Why then have you not written networking goals for your business? Networking seems to be one of those things that many people do as a reaction to no or slow business. It often gets forgotten. It is rarely treated as an integral part of how we grow our businesses. Not only is it frequently neglected, but most people are haphazard in their approach to networking, and far from systematic. This approach to networking can keep you from ever getting close to the 29%. This first strategy helps you avoid the pitfalls of treating networking as an afterthought, as something far less than what it can be for your business. One way to systematize and organize your approach to networking is to set measurable networking goals. As our friend Deanna Tucci-Schmidt, owner of BNI Western Pennsylvania, often says, without a goal, you have nothing at which to aim. We would add that if you don't have a goal, you can't measure your results. That which gets written gets done, as our colleague Tom Fleming in Florida would say. SMART goals. Each goal you create should be SMART: specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and timed with a deadline. Let's take a moment to clarify the concept of a SMART goal. Specific. The goal must be clearly defined with parameters that state who, what, when, where, and how. Specific goals help you stay focused on one thing at a time. For example, stating that you want to become a member of a networking group is fine, but you can define your goal more clearly by saying that you want to become a member of a specific chamber or a particular BNI chapter. Measurable. The goal must include a way of measuring the results. This typically means that there is a number associated with the goal, such as how many, or what percentage, some quantifiable way to measure progress toward the goal. Stating that you want to receive more referrals this year is neither specific nor measurable. It's more useful to say specifically that you want a 30% increase in your referral business from a networking group. Attainable. Each goal that you create must be within reach. It should not be so far-fetched that it's out of your vision. To determine whether a goal is attainable, consider what you accomplished this year. Then consider what you have coming up next year that may either impede or improve your ability to meet a specific goal. Finally, consider everything that needs to be done to accomplish your goal. When all is said and done, do you honestly feel that with hard work, dedication, and focus, you can meet this goal? If so, write it down and commit to achieving it. Relevant. The goal must have relevance and meaning for you. Otherwise, you will not be motivated to accomplish it. What will be the outcome if you meet a particular goal? Will you make more money? Will you have a higher quality of life? Will you be able to save for retirement more comfortably? Will you get a promotion or a raise? Will you save time in the long run? Whatever your personal motivation, ensure that your goals tap into it. Doing so will inspire you every day to keep striving toward the finish line. Timed. Speaking of a finish line, the goal must have a deadline or completion date assigned to it. Without one, you will lose your focus and your desire to meet your goal in a timely manner. Our human competitive nature draws us to the finish line. We need to aim for a target. For example, stating that you want a 30% increase in your referral business from your participation in a networking group is indeed specific and measurable, but how long will it take, and when will you measure it? Stating that you want a 30% increase in your annual referral business from the organization by December 31st will be much more effective because it contains a deadline. When you put all of these elements together, you might end up with a goal statement that looks like one of these. I will become a member of the ABC Chamber by June 30th. I will achieve a 30% increase in my annual referral business from networking in a certain networking group by December 31st. We know that setting goals, smart goals, can be difficult, but we've also seen how powerful they can be, as well as the consequences of not giving them their due. Collectively, your two co-authors have written many training curricula. Each one starts with the goal in mind. We've been well-trained, for how can we even begin to organize material into a training seminar without first having the end in mind? We typically formulate a set of questions that must be answered before we can move ahead to designing the curriculum. Stephen Covey validates this concept in his The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. One of his strategies is to begin with the end in mind. These questions that come later, adapted from his book, will help you focus on what you want to accomplish through networking. Once you begin your own goal-setting process, however, don't limit yourself to these questions. Week 1 Action. Your task this week is to answer, in writing, not simply in your head, each of the following questions as honestly and as fully as you can. They will provide a structure that will help you create your goal statements. Besides, you have to set your goals before you can design a plan for meeting them. We'll focus on developing that plan in week 2, so we encourage you to approach this goal-setting process with enthusiasm and diligence. Remember, you're building that foundation for your networking home. Questions for sample networking goals. 1. How much business do you want to get from word-of-mouth referrals, and by when? What do you need to do for this to happen? Who will bring you this business? What kind of business do you expect to get from referrals? Will the referrals focus on a specific product or service? 2. How many networking functions will you attend each month? How will you find out about these functions? What will you accomplish at these functions? 3. How many referrals do you want each week, each month? 4. How many of the techniques in this book will you begin each month? 5. What 5 things will you do differently to network your business? 6. With whom do you want to meet this year? List anything that comes to mind. Businesses, professions, names of specific people you'd like to meet. 7. Of which networking groups would you like to become a member this year? Additional exercise. Although we don't want you to get too far ahead of the process, you might choose to go through this book and identify a few strategies that look appropriate for the goal statements you've created. Make notes so you can revisit them later. Week 2. Block out time to network. In order to perform like the successful, exceptional networkers in the original 6 degrees of separation study, you might actually need to change some behaviors. There are 4 steps to changing a behavior: want it, learn it, try it, and live it. You were motivated to buy this book because you wanted to learn how to do this thing called networking more effectively. Congratulations! You've accomplished step 1. Having determined that you want the information, step 2 is to learn it. That involves actually listening to this book. Congratulations again! You've made it this far. Keep going. Once you learn this information, move to step 3. Try it out. Listening to the book is good, but executing the strategies in the book is better. This is not a book that should just sit on your bookshelf. For the next 12 months, keep it on your desktop to remind you every day of the reason you bought it in the first place. The true purpose of this book is to keep you working on your business by implementing the 52 strategies to network your business effectively and efficiently. After you begin trying out the strategies, the last step in successfully implementing this material is to live it. This requires a continuing commitment on your part to execute what you learn, not just by trying one strategy each week, but by...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.